Hello. Today we're going to look at an unusual and what is for a lot of people going to be an unexpected scientific discovery. And the discovery consists of the observation that certain chi healers, certain chi workers, people who deal with subtle energies, or as they're known in China, where they're a lot less exotic than they seem here in the West, chi kung healing. And what happened was that a scientist observed very high magnetic fields being emitted from the hands of a chi healer. The study was carried out by several scientists in Japan who measured the biomagnetic field strength in 37 subjects. And of those 37 subjects, only three of them exhibited strong biomagnetic fields, and these were on the order of 2 to 4 milligauss in the frequency range of 4 to 10 hertz. That's a very low frequency, and it includes the theta range. Very interestingly, I think, the fields that were measured from the chi master's hands was 1,000 times stronger than the normal field strength we find in humans. One of those subjects was measured to see if there was a corresponding electric current, because there are certain laws of physics that tell us that whenever there's a magnetic field, we can also look to find corresponding electrical activity. It did not appear. Now, anyone who wants to can simply pause the video at this point and you'll be able to get a closer look. Now, about 20 years later, some researchers decided to look into it again, and they published what they said was a repeat of some experiments, including the one I just showed you, to see whether or not they could actually detect the magnetic. There was a problem with their supposed replication. While the original experiment used 37 subjects and got three of them to demonstrate this very high magnetic field, Baldwin et al. Only used three subjects who had any experience with Reiki. So it looks like about 8% of Seto's original subjects demonstrated these strong magnetic fields. They only had three Reiki masters, as they called them in their study, and as a result, even if they had the same percent of subjects producing these very strong magnetic fields, it still might have never shown up in their data. Besides this, Seto's subjects had to satisfy three conditions. They had to make the claim that they could emit external chi, as he called it. They had to have other people who were willing to vouch for their ability, and they had to be ordinary, healthy people. No such criteria was applied in the so-called replication study. So here's a pie chart showing the number of subjects in the so-called replication compared with the number of subjects in the original study. And as you can see, the so-called replication simply isn't. Yeah, they would have needed a much larger number of subjects in order for the same size effect to have appeared. And for the last 10 years or so, we've been hearing about a thing called the replication crisis. And this is especially applicable to behavioral studies, as well as many studies in psychology, in which replication isn't able to get the same results as the original study. And this difference between the Seto procedure and the Baldwin procedure, between the original and the so-called replication, makes me wonder how many of the replication studies actually replicate the original conditions, the original procedures, the original subjects of the first study. Very often, in my experience studying these things, I find that many researchers, when they're doing replications, are willing to cut corners, especially if they're skeptical about the initial result. If they're skeptical, they want to see it fail, and by setting up the to substandard standards, they're able to arrange for just that. So let's have a look at another study to do with Reiki and Qi and so forth. So if we can assume that the reason that Reiki or Qi has the strong and very positive reputation that it has in Asia, we have to wonder how the healing is accomplished, what is being transmitted between the practitioner and their client. Now, one way that we can be sure that there is something being transmitted or there is some information being shared is not just to look at how effective the Reiki practice is. There are many studies examining the efficacy, the effectiveness of Reiki, but what we're looking at here is how Reiki actually works. And this study gives us an important hint. It showed that the brain activity between the subject and the client or the patient was stronger during the Reiki session than it would have been otherwise. And this was limited to the theta range and also only over the left hemisphere of the brain. So it looks as if there's one information conduit connecting the two that only affects a certain part of the brain of the subject and the practitioner. Now, that may not sound like very much. Some people might think, well, that why don't their whole brains become more coherent? And the answer is probably because it simply isn't necessary. It may be that only a little bit of electrical or magnetic activity is affected in this process, but that doesn't have any necessary bearing over the outcome. You can take a tiny little remote control, connect it to an electric front end loader, and what will happen is that you can use a minuscule amount of energy to tell the front end loader, the construction equipment, to turn on, and then once it's on, it can use an enormous amount of power. So this metaphor allows us to understand how tiny changes in the brains of those who are doing or receiving Reiki might actually be able to affect a large change in the patient's health. Here is a layout of the differences in coherency, again in the theta band, again over the left hemisphere, with subjects and controls. The solid line shows the degree of coherency with Reiki, and the broken line shows the degree of coherency with only the sham control subjects, or as they're called in this paper, the naive subjects who had never experienced Reiki before. So you can see that there's a significant difference. It's not an enormous difference, but you don't need an enormous difference in power or an enormous amount of power in order to make the change. Again, think of our remote that turns on a piece of construction equipment which can then go and lift many tons of material at once with a command beginning from a remote control that might use only tiny amounts of electricity. So we have to wonder how this might work. And there's another study that we can look at that will give us a little. In this study, published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, that's an extremely prestigious scientific journal, we find that there is brain-to-brain coupling in the 8 to 12 hertz range while a person who's in pain is holding hands with someone who's there to support them. And these findings suggest that it may be due to direct exchange or sharing of information between the two brains outside of any known mechanism for sharing information. To put it a little bit crudely, we're talking about telepathy here, although that's a word that invites ridicule. For a lot of journals and a lot of scientists don't like to use it anymore. Now they talk about brain-to-brain coupling. And the reason for that is that some brain-to-brain communication could be direct transmission of magnetic signals from one person to another, or it may be the result of activity in mirror neurons. And the hypothesis we're being offered here is that very weak magnetic fields may be the way information is transmitted from one brain to another. Here it says animals' brains, because such results have been found in animals as well as in humans. But the point is simply that magnetic fields, whose strength rises and falls in sync with the brain's electrical activity. Again, I remind all of my watchers that there's an intimate relationship between electrical activity and magnetic fields. Wherever there's an electric current or an electric pulse, there will be a corresponding magnetic field or burst of magnetism. So there have been a few people who've been working on this, including Dr. Michael A. Persinger, but he's not the only one who's onto this train of thought, this line of research. Faint magnetic fields can bear information, and magnetic fields can travel very long distances without any significant attenuation or reduction of their field strength or their capacity to bear information. An astute viewer might wonder whether or not this kind of information sharing between human brains is limited to healing processes and things that make us feel better, or if it also comes up in more unpleasant circumstances. And the answer is, yes, it does. So let's have a quick look at this study. And remember, anytime you see a study that's interesting to you, you can simply press pause, write down the name of the study, and then you'll be able to go and look it up for yourself. If your screen is large enough, you can also just look at the highlighted areas in each of the studies that I lay in front of our. And the title of the article is Suffer Together, Bond Together. Brain-to-brain synchronization and mutual affective empathy, that means emotional empathy, when sharing painful experiences. And one of the quotes from this study, which used EEG to monitor two people, one of whom was in pain and the other was not, it said that expecting high-intensity pain induced greater brain-to-brain synchronization than did low-intensity pain. Further goes on to say that these results support the hypothesis that sharing a painful experience triggers emotional resonance through brain-to-brain synchronization and motivates pro-social behavior within pairs of individuals. In other words, brain-to-brain synchronization helps us to get along together, especially as revealed in this study, when pairs of individuals are relating to one another. Sympathy and empathy are not just a good idea, they're also part of our primary evolutionary strategy. There are lots of other circumstances in which human brains can become sort of locked or synchronized with one another. In this case, guitarists playing together were more synchronized and seemed to have more shared activity between their two brains when they were playing than when they weren't. And the more difficult the composition, the more the guitarist brains lock together, especially in two bands of brain activity. And this study involved 12 pairs of subjects. And the same has also been found in singing. When individuals sing together, their brains, part of their brain activity, tends to synchronize and link up with one another. The left inferior frontal cortex, that's shown in blue, were more synchronized when two people were singing together. And here's another one, involving pilots and co-pilots, who showed dense patterns of connectivity when they were both working together, but not when they were doing different jobs. When one person tells a story to another person, the two of their brains, both of their brains, tended to synchronize activity with one another. This suggested to these researchers that brain entrainment is not merely a side or epiphenomena associated with auditory processing, but it's actually part of our communication style and strategy. And here is another one, in which in ordinary conversations, the brains of couples, boyfriends and girlfriends, husbands and wives, synchronized far more than those of strangers who had been introduced and asked to participate in the experiment. If they knew each other and they were romantically, sexually involved, lifetime partnerships and so forth, their brains synchronized when one of them was talking to another. And if they had just met, that didn't happen. One that shows us that there's more synchronization in the brains of mothers and children when the kids and the mothers took turns talking. So when one was talking, the other was listening, and vice versa. And of course, this is hard to explain in terms of mirror neuron activity, Because the job of listening and the job of talking, as far as the brain are concerned, are very, very different. The listener does not sympathize with the person telling the story. They sympathize with the people in the story, or they focus on the events in the story. That's very, very different from focusing on the speaker. And here is another one that explains how direct eye contact between mothers and infants increases their, and I quote, neural coupling. The things people will say in order to avoid looking like they believe in telepathy. Here is another one between mothers and children, and it shows that there was increased synchronization in the gamma range when mothers and children watched videos of themselves interacting, but it only came up with positive interactions. If they showed a video to the mother and child pair of them arguing or having a dispute about something, it didn't come up. So what we're talking about here is something that definitely increases human bonding, and by extension, we can probably infer that it decreases human conflict. So this is not limited only to human beings. It appears to be a factor for many social species, including rats and bats. So let's have a quick closer look at those. And this study showed that the frontal lobes of mice had correlated or linked activity that depended on ongoing social activity. When two of the mice were relating to each other, their frontal lobe activity became more correlated with one another, and when they weren't relating to one another, then it didn't. Here are the bats. It's almost the same result, but it's interesting to see it in more than one species. Neural activity in pairs of bats correlated between them and increased when they were interacting socially. So let me try and give you a brief summary. Qi looks like it's a magnetic phenomena. Reiki appears to synchronize some of the activity between the brains of the practitioner and the brains of their client. Qi, Reiki, can also result in magnetic fields in the practitioner's hands, and magnetic fields can convey information between brains. Spiritual healing may work by conveying or moving or transmitting information from the healer's brain to the client's brain via some kind of magnetic conduit or channel in the healer's hands. Healing hands, whether it's healing by laying on hands, spiritual healing, energy healing, quantum healing, you name it, all of these modalities from so many different places in the world and that have been in the world for so very long, healing hands may actually be healing brains. And that's it. Thanks for watching. Please like the video. Please subscribe to my channel. And I'll see you with the next one. Thank you.